Well, good morning, Ontario Church family. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Always good to worship Him in spirit and in truth. On behalf of the Ontario Church family and half of our associate pastor who's there in the back, Peter Ron, myself, the senior pastor, Gresford Thomas, I'd like to welcome you, whether you're joining us online or here. We're just so happy to have you here with us today, and we hope that you'll receive a blessing by everything that is experienced in this place. We do it all for the glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd just like to mention and remind you that in front of you are blue connection cards. If there's anything that you would like to communicate to myself or Pastor Ahn, please fill them out. If there's any prayer requests also, you can fill them out on that card as well. And they are taken to our prayer team, and we do pray for each one of those requests. So I'd like to invite you to be able to do that at your leisure there in front of you on the blue connection cards. There are a couple of announcements that I would like to make, the first of which is following our worship service today is our monthly meet and greet. What is that, you may ask? That is just an opportunity to go out in our courtyard. There will be some food, some snacks available, and it's just a time for fellowship and connection following our worship service. If you're here, please step outside, grab a snack, say hello to one another. Let's just take time to fellowship after the time that we've had of worship. That'll happen right after our worship service today through this door in our courtyard area. Next announcement is after that, we will be serving our community today. We have a food pantry that we are now doing on a regular basis every first and third, and if there's a fifth Sabbath, we do it on a fifth Sabbath as well. We'll be meeting at 1:30 in the parking lot right behind the building, the community services building, the White House, for those of you who know it as that. And we'll be setting things up and getting ready to meet members of our community, to provide them with food, a smile, and just words of encouragement. As we begin to do this on a regular basis, more and more people are coming. We have plenty of food to distribute. We do need the help. I'd like to invite you, if you're not part of the community services team officially, come out and experience the joy of serving our community on this Sabbath day. That will start at 1:30 following our meet and greet. I'd like to talk about our MindFit event, and that's going to be April 4 to 7. We do have cards that we will have in the back and over to the side that we'll be handing out to individuals. We'd like to ask you to take them. We have 1,000 of them. So take them and hand them to people. There's a QR code that you can register online. But we also have a ministry that will be happening at 2 o'clock today. And I'm going to ask Charles to come up, and he's going to be talking about what we'll be doing in that regard.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. So today we are going out to pass out more MindFit flyers. Today, when I say we, it's basically me. I was just only me going out tonight, today. So if anybody can join me and help me out with passing out flyers, I would really appreciate it. But another thing is a lot of people have been really receptive and really thankful for us even talking about this. So just being able to be God's witness for, you know, this community is a very powerful thing. And as Pastor said, if you can see or grab one of those MindFit flyers, they're at the podiums and the entrance, and pass it to somebody that you know, pass it to a family member, a friend, just anybody you're just in close contact. It doesn't even have to be, this event is not about them being you know, needing therapy. It's just having that conversation. So if you just know somebody, it would be very helpful to pass it out. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Charles. I appreciate you and Heidi stepping forward in this ministry. Again, this is not a therapy session. This is just a session where we are showing that we understand that there are mental health needs out there in the community, and that we want to be able to engage and build and take away the stigma that's there with mental health problems that people may have. It's also there to know that we are here as a support, and another thing we're going to be doing is providing connections to people that may be able to help them if people truly need that. So please pass out flyers. We have so many of them. We also have glow tracks that go along with it. I'd like to invite you to pick one up on your way out so that we can get things moving in that regard. Tomorrow at 9:30, we have a church work bee. Lunch will be provided. We have two areas of focus. As you're walking in, you'll see there's some books on the floor. They're books that we've been trying to get rid of. We're going to be cleaning that up. We're also going to be working on our garage. Those are going to be the two areas of focus, 9:30 tomorrow. Have any questions, please see our head deacon, Cassandra Lopez, and she can answer those questions. But your help would be appreciated to come out. We do try to do this once a quarter to keep our church in good working order. We appreciate your help with that. Every Wednesday, there is prayer meeting. Meets here in the transept. You're all invited to come. And every Thursday, there is a women's devotional meeting that happens both via Zoom and also in person in the youth room. The Zoom information is in your bulletin if you'd like to attend that. My wife leads that out if you need more information. And for prayer meeting, you could see me if you'd like more information on that. But it is a blessed time of coming together, seeking God on behalf of our church family. And it's something that we look forward to. We also have a time of discussing the Bible. It's really a time of connection and growing as a church family. If you can, please come out. Consider that a personal invitation. At this time, I'm going to ask Gabby Navarro to come up. She has an announcement about a special event that we have next weekend.
Happy Sabbath, church. So in 6 days, this coming Friday, we are going to be hosting a very special event for our youth and young adults. But as it has been mentioned before, the overall message can be beneficial to all of us. I want to invite everyone to consider being part of this much needed event. But before I tell you how you can be involved, I want to share with you why as a church we need to support our young people. In recent data published by the General Conference Office of the Archive Statistics and Research, the data show for the North America Division that 43.2% of the population or the members in our church are of age 60 and up. 38% is between the ages 41 and 60. 13.91% is between the ages of 26 and 40. And only 4.5% of the population in our church is under the age of 25. So as you can see, our church is facing a major crisis in youth retention. As a church, we're missing a big blessing if we don't have young people. Psalms 144:12-15 says, "Then our sons and their youth will be like well-nurtured plants, and our daughters will be like pillars carved to adorn a palace. Blessed is the people whom this is true. Blessed is the people whose God is the Lord." We as the church need to build and nurture our newer generations, those late millennials, Generation Z, and the upcoming Alpha, Generation Alpha, to continue moving the message forward using their talents, perspectives, and approaches. Ms. White in the book Education, page 271, states, "With such an army of workers as our youth, rightly trained, mighty furnished, how soon the message of a crucified, risen, and soon coming Savior might be carried to the whole world." We need our youth, but we're in a crisis. So how can you help? So I invite you to invite a young person, maybe a relative, a coworker, or a friend's young son or daughter. Maybe invite someone with a young person at home. Maybe it's someone that you've been witnessing to, helping, comforting that parent that has a young person at home who really needs to understand that the struggle is real. And I want to add that if you have young children at home, and you might think, well, this is for the young. This is for the young adults. No, this is for you. This is for you to be able to train yourself and see what's coming ahead in that developmental stage so you can be ready to help your child be that young youth that can stay in the church. And most importantly, that knows God, the real God. Share a flyer. Take it to your job. Take it to the grocery store where you go and there's people. Maybe post it on your social media. Also, you can volunteer. You can be a part of the group of hospitality. Sean and I, you can talk to us. We can set you somewhere. And please, please, register. We need everyone, young and old, to register. We need to make food preparations, and we want to be good stewards of the money that has been given to us for this event. And finally, something that everyone can do is pray. Please consider praying every day around 6 o'clock. Pray for this event. We cannot do it. We need to reach out to everyone. So at this time, I invite you to scan the QR code. You have our permission to take out your phones, scan it, and register. Also, as you register, please set up an alarm. 6 o'clock, pray. Everybody here, I know everyone knows a young person, whether it's a teen, a preteen, a young adult, please put them in your prayers. Do whatever it takes to bring them. You have to bring them. God does the converting. Amen. I know that I've been praying for a couple of people. I went as far as promising $100 to two. And I took this advice from Pastor Ty Gibson, who said, do whatever it takes. And I said, okay. And he said, even if you have to give them $100. So I said, okay. So I went out. I reached out to these two people who I know I want them to be here. And I said, hey, if you come the three nights, I promise you $100 will be given to you. I know that they're going to get more than $100. But I have people in prayer. I have friends, children that I know that are in my prayers. So please be a part of this event by attending, by praying, by fasting, by publishing it somewhere. Please, we encourage our church to come together and not miss out in the blessing that God promises if we have young people among us. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Gabby, for sharing that appeal, not for the event, but for our young people. And that's what this is about, first and foremost. So I hope that you will scan the QR code, you'll take a look at the flyer, and come in support. If you don't have a young person, please do come and support. It starts next Friday evening, and goes into Sabbath, all the way to the end of the Sabbath hours. I'm looking forward to it, the opportunity to see young people's lives change for kingdom purposes. Thank you, Gabby, for presenting that. The 30th of this month, we do have our second annual paint night. There's 17 seats available. Is there 17? Is that okay? Good. 17 seats available. You have the QR code there. You can go ahead and register that way, or you could see Tasi Alvarado. She's over here greeting at this time. You could also see her and sign up for it. It's an awesome time. Next week, I'm going to put some pictures from last year so that you could see what a wonderful time that we had during this event. But what it is you're able to take this wonderful piece of art and wonder, can I paint that? And somehow, some way, the instructor, who is Tasi Alvarado, gets you to use your pinky and touch up the paint and use a pencil and do these other things. And before you know it, you have this beautiful work of art that you could frame and put in your house. It's a miracle. It was a miracle for me, but I'm not art inclined in any way. But what I'm saying is that come out. It's not just about art, but it's about fellowship and coming together as a church family. I'd like to invite you to be there during that time. One other announcement I'd like to make, and it's news that we all need to be aware of. Our dear sister, Hilding Downs, who's a longtime member, on Monday, she went to her rest. I just wanted to announce that. I was asked to make that announcement for everyone. We will talk about arrangements at a later time, but I wanted everyone to know that Hilding Downs, who has been a member of this church for many years, has not been able to come recently because of health challenges, but she did go to her rest this past Monday. Please keep the family in prayer. This time, I'd like to ask our praise team to come forward and lead us into our time of worship. We're going to sing the doxology, praise God from whom all blessings flow. I'd like to ask us to stand as we invite the Lord's presence to be with us. Praise, all glory, all honor go to you, our God and our King, the one who woke us up this morning to see another day and brought us to this place to be able to rest in the work of another, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to remember and commemorate that he is the creator of all things, including a new heart within each and every one of us. Lord, as we enter this time of worship, we pray that your presence will be with us. We pray that you will guide every song that is sung, every word that is said. Lord, it's all for your glory. May we leave this place changed, drawing closer to Jesus Christ and closer to one another. We ask and pray these things in his matchless name. Amen and amen.
Seated. Our first song is called I Cannot What. I Cannot Tell Why.
I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the souls of men, or why a shepherd he should seek the wanderers
next song is Because He Lives, number 526. Opening song, I Surrender All. All to Jesus I surrender. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. It's good to be here. Amen. Before I ask the deacons to stand, I just want to share a little story, and I did get permission from my son to share this story. As you may know, my son, CJ, he's very shy. So when he got the text that the text was for me, that he's going to do the scripture reading, he kind of stressed a little bit. But as often I remind him, when you get the call, it may come from a person, yes, but ultimately that call is from God. And when God calls, we answer. And looking at the deacons today, I'm so proud to see our young children, our young people participating. And as we know from 2 Corinthians 9:7, so let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or out of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And when we give, it's not always financial, is it? It's our time. It's our effort. And when we give, God asks for one thing, that we do it cheerfully in our hearts. So today's offering is for the local church budget. As a reminder, that our tithe goes to the general conference for worldly evangelistic activities, right, that we need to spread globally. But the local church needs our support. And when we give, let's remember to give cheerfully, because I'll tell you, this house of the Lord is such a blessing. Amen. After a work of labor, I am so happy to be here with you and to be with God. And we need to support this church. Can I ask the deacons to please stand as we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, first of all, thank you for this church so that we can congregate and worship you together. This house where we can rest and enjoy time spent with you, our King and Savior. Dear Lord, as we give, may our hearts be abundantly joyful, and we give with a cheerful heart. And may you bless and multiply the monies. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, church family, it's now time for the Garden of Prayer. So if those of you who are able, who want to come to the front, you have a special petition that you want to bring before the Lord, I ask that you join me as we kneel in prayer. For those who wish to remain seated in the pew, please please do so, but if you can, please kneel with us as we pray. Thank you. Father, we thank you once again just for the gift of life, dear God. You woke us up today on this beautiful Sabbath day. You brought us here to church to worship and fellowship with one another, dear God. So we thank you for that blessing. You know, I often tell my kids it's so overlooked, dear God, that you just give us that extra day of life because tomorrow is promised to no one, dear God. So help us to appreciate each day that we have. You know, sad news hearing about our sister. Hildene Downs, dear God, and you know, I think of many the pillars of this church, dear God, who have been laid to rest, dear God. But you know, we can be assured because I know they had faith. I know they believed, and on that glorious day, dear God, when you return, it's going to be amazing to see. You know, not how they looked then, but you know, when they're in their glorified bodies, dear God. And I know we'll recognize them because. And it's just going to be an awesome sight in heaven, dear God, just to get to meet with all of them and just be reunited, dear God, not only with our church pillars, dear God, but with our loved ones. So just keep reminding us, dear God, of that because, you know, this world is getting crazier and crazier, dear God, but we have nothing to fear. And I thank you for that because what is there to fear, dear God, if we lose our life, but we lose it for you, we gain that eternity. So help us not to live a life in fear, but live a life of expectation, dear God. I ask for a special blessing for these events that are coming up, dear God, the one for the youth, the mind fit, and everything else that's in motion and plans for this church, especially for today. We're going to be doing the food pantry, dear God, and I ask for good weather. You know, we still had many families come out the last time we had it, even though it was raining, it was, you know, raining and pouring, but the kids were still out there excited, holding the signs, letting people know that the food pantry was still on. But let it be nice weather today. Help us to continue to bless this community, but may the community see that we're different, dear God, and may they want to come and worship with us and get to know you better. Special prayer for Pastor, dear God, as he brings the message today. May his words be your words, dear God. May his tongue be used to uplift you, but also help our hearts to be uplifted by the words that you are giving him. And just, you know, thank you once again, dear Father, for the opportunity and the freedom to come and worship like we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's time for the children's story. I'd like to invite everyone to come on up. And as you come up, if you can collect the lamb's offering. can all gather around over here. So we can get the baskets out. And you can gather around the... You can even sit on this. This is okay. Hello, Mr. Kinney. Well, happy Sabbath to everyone. Well, I have a story for you today. And it is actually a true story. You want a true story? Angry. Well, we're here to be happy. So I'm going to tell a story. One of the things that I love to do is go fishing. Another thing I love to do, especially when I was younger, was to spend time with my friends. And I had a friend, and we went fishing all the time. And when we would go fishing, we would go right up in the mountains up here. If you look up in the mountains, there's a place called Cucamonga Canyon. Cucamonga Canyon. And in the middle of Cucamonga Canyon, do you know what there is? Well, if there's fish, what does there have to be? I hear a lake, I hear water, what else? A stream, a river, a stream. And we would go up there, but we would get dropped off at the bottom, and we have to walk up to the stream. And as we walked up to the stream, carrying our fishing stuff, backpacks, we always looked for something. Anyone want to guess what we looked for before we got up to the stream? Fish. Not going to find fish in the bushes. Not worms. Snakes. Your favorite. So what we would do is we would walk, and if the road went one way and to the other, we would each walk on the road, and we'd be looking in the road for what we called snake slithers. You could see where the snake had gone across the road. I apologize to the ladies over here if you don't like snakes. Trigger warning. And we would look at where the snake slithers were, and then we would look in the bushes and try to find the snake. So as we were walking up, we saw what looked like a real fresh snake slither. And my friend looked in the bushes and saw part of the snake. If I could have the first picture. If we have it. No. What kind of snake is that? Does anybody know? No. That is a California king snake. And California king snakes, are they bad snakes or are they good snakes? They're good snakes. They usually don't bite you. You can usually pick them up. So as my friend went into the bush, he sees the black and the white stripes of the tail of the what he thought was a king snake, and he starts diving into the bush. Because, you know, a king snake, I don't have to worry about anything. Well, and they don't have venom, and they can't do anything to you. And they're not scared. Well, it was trying to get away. But what he did, he jumped in, and I was right behind him, and I looked. But I saw something that he didn't. He yells, "King snake," and jumps in the bush, and I'm looking, and I grabbed him by his belt area, and I threw him about 10 feet behind. Why would I do that?
I don't know.
It was a different snake.
It was a different snake. What snake do you think it was? Rattlesnake. Does a rattlesnake look anything like this?
No.
How could you confuse this for a rattlesnake? Or a rattlesnake for this?
I know.
But I saw something he didn't. What do you think I saw? What do you think?
He jumped into the bush.
Well, he jumped in, but what do you think I saw that my friend who was diving after the snake didn't see? One snake.
Two.
Nope. I saw rattles.
So he was a rattlesnake?
So if I can see the next picture, and you see, how can you confuse a king snake for a rattlesnake? Do you see how that could happen right there? What do you see?
A rattlesnake.
It's the back tail is like a king snake.
The back tail is like a king snake. So he looked in the bush and he saw that little bit of that. And he dived in the bush And then I looked and I saw the rest of the snake come out, and there was a rattle right there. So at first when I grabbed him, do you think he was real happy when I grabbed him and threw him across the road? He wasn't too happy. He's over there dusty on his backside. It's like, what do you do that for? And I said, it's a rattlesnake. He's like, no. So we went in and looked, and sure enough, it was a rattlesnake. But those two snakes don't look anything alike, do they?
No.
But you see the confusion?
I told you it was a rattlesnake.
You were correct. Sometimes we see things that we think are right, but they're not. Well, I brought something today.
Snake?
I brought two snakes. I brought two snakes. Where's everyone going? Okay. And I guarantee you these snakes are not fake. And one of them is a rattlesnake. And one of them is a gopher snake. Can you hold this for me, Kenny? I need to be careful.
All right.
So I have a question. Which one is the rattlesnake? And which one is the gopher snake? How many of you think that the one closest to me is the rattlesnake? How many think that the one closest to everyone else is the rattlesnake? These are two snakes that get confused quite a bit.
Yeah.
And I'm going to see the next picture of... See this snake here?
That's a gopher snake.
That's a gopher snake. But see how it looks kind of similar to a rattlesnake?
It's bigger than the rattlesnake.
It is.
And the rattlesnake has this kind.
You guys can touch this. It's fine.
It's like just paper.
These are real snakes.
Okay.
Real snakes that I... Unfortunately, this one here was one that was a pet that I had that died. So I skinned it. And this was a rattlesnake that I thought needed to be a snake skin. So it became one. So this is a Western diamondback rattlesnake. And if you look at it, you see the diamond pattern on there? And if I can get to the picture before with the rattlesnake, if you look at the picture there, can you see the shape of the head?
I do.
It has a small neck and a big head. Almost all this, if you see it. Yep. And if you see a snake that has a little head,
like
I mean a big head and a little neck, it's almost always going to be poisonous. But there are good snakes and there are bad snakes.
And I do not like the poison.
I'm not too fond of them either. But when you look at them, it's good to be able to tell the difference. So you could easily say that this is a rattlesnake and this is a gopher snake, which are very calm snakes that you can usually just pick up.
Pennsylvania, that the ones that have like a triangle head are poisonous and the ones that have a round head are not.
And that is true for here in California. So we have these, and I know snakes pretty well, so I can tell these apart real easily. And what I want to see is, how can you tell the difference? These are real. I skinned these myself. Yep.
You
have to dry it, and then you scrape off whatever gets on the inside, and then
I put brake fluid on it to help tan the hides. So we have those. But when you look at the snakes, sometimes they can be confused. You could even confuse something like the rattlesnake for a king snake. Yeah. But sometimes something might look, have a whole, it's just old. It might have a lot of truth and a little bit of error on the back. Or it looks like a king snake, but the rest of it's all bad. And we can be fooled sometimes, so it's good to know. And how do we know what's right and what's wrong? Telling the truth. How do you know what the truth is? Who knows? Have you ever thought of that we learn what the truth is from the Bible? Jesus said that he is the truth, the way, the truth, and the life. So if you read your Bibles, you hear the Bible stories, and you hear what it means to be good, that's the best way to know truth from error so that no one can fool you. So if someone shows you a gopher snake and says it's a rattlesnake, you go, no, I know that's a gopher snake. You need to be able to know. Yep, you want to know the truth. And if you study the Bible, read your Bible, do your lesson, and listen to your parents. It's what? But that's not all. These do get a little longer. Rattlesnakes are usually, they can get pretty fat. So we... Yep. So we better have prayer so we don't take too much time. So does anyone want to have a prayer for us today?
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for our families. Thank you for this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Today's scripture reading is found in Matthew 7, 28-29. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law.
At this point, it seems I need to wish you a good afternoon. Still good to be in the house of the Lord, and I must admit, I was going to have someone else here to be preaching today, but they weren't able to make it. One of your former pastors, Ben Martin, but he's in the area, but he wasn't able to make it today. But we're going to, you know, worship the Lord and. And the beauty of his holiness, and the title of the message today, as you can see, is Wisdom in Crowds. Wisdom in Crowds. And what we're going to be exploring and looking at today is this aspect of the Sermon on the Mount. And as you can imagine from the illustration, we're going to be looking at this most famous sermon in the world, and the words spoken in this sermon were spoken to a crowd who thought they understood the purposes of God's kingdom and their role within God's kingdom as well. But little did they know that when Jesus opened up and started speaking, their world was going to be turned upside down. Now today, what we're going to do is we're just going to take a few moments to discuss how these same words can turn our world and our church upside down as we understand them through the lens of Jesus. We're not going to be looking at the entire sermon. We're going to be looking at the Beatitudes, just an overview. But we're going to be looking at this aspect of how the Sermon on the Mount was affected by the wisdom within the crowd. Let's have a word of prayer before we begin. Father in heaven, I pray that you would open my lips so my mouth may declare your glory. Let the words that I speak be seasoned with your love and grace. And may we leave this place having been changed into your image by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Title of today's message comes from a book written in 2004 by a gentleman by the name of James Surowiecki. And the name of that book is Wisdom of Crowds. Now, the topic of the book is Wisdom of Crowds, but it's called Why the Many Are Smarter Than the Few and How Collective Wisdom Shapes Business, Economies, Societies, and Nations. It's a very interesting book. It was actually suggested to me by my former ministerial director as far as relating it to the church. And as I looked through it, I found some very interesting aspects of it as it relates to Scripture. Now, this aspect of wisdom of crowds is the idea that large groups of people are collectively smarter than individual experts when it comes to problem solving, decision making, innovating, and predicting. And the idea is that the viewpoint of an individual can inherently be biased. Whereas if you take the average knowledge of a crowd, it can result in eliminating that bias or noise, if you will, to produce a clearer and more coherent result. This is not a new concept as far as the wisdom of crowds. We see it laid out in Scripture by King Solomon in Proverbs chapter 15, verse 22. Here's what he says. Without counsel, plans go awry, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. In other words, goals and purposes, when they are met and when plans are submitted by the wisdom of others, there's something that happens. Often we can spot flaws or shortcomings that we can't see in and of ourselves. I can tell you something. I worked on the bulletin, and a lot of times it takes a wisdom of crowds to be able to point out things that I missed just by myself looking at it. The point is not to gather as many options as possible in a flurry of decisions, but to consider more opinions than one's own in order to make a good decision. Wise people listen to advice. Foolish people, they reject counsel. Now, we talk about this principle a little further. It applies to the wisdom of crowds as well as the wisdom of God Almighty. That is the source of ultimate wisdom. Here's what the psalmist says about the wisdom of God, because we're going to look at the wisdom of crowds, but we also have to look at the wisdom of God as well as it relates to that. In Psalm chapter 32, verse 8, here's what the psalmist says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. It's a short verse, but there's a lot said in there. He uses three words to describe what he will do. It says, I will instruct you. It says, I will teach you. And then it says, I will guide you. To instruct means to give comprehension and understanding for the purpose of achieving success. Understanding for the purpose of achieving success. In other words, we could say God is our life coach, if we allow him to be. His commands, his laws and counsel as given in the Bible are meant to help us navigate through the many pitfalls and challenges that life has to offer. It helps us to find success. And success is in, in his hands as we follow his plans. Next, it says that he will teach us. This word in the original language means to lay a foundation. To teach someone is to lay a foundation for that individual. When we allow God to teach us, we understand that the kingdom of heaven starts here and now. Everything we do in the here and now lays a foundation for preparing us to see Jesus face to face. Everything we do lays the foundations to help us to become an example and a blessing to those we come in contact with. When God teaches us, when God lays that foundation within our hearts, he is building his life. He is building his power. He is inserting his spirit. He's building his presence and purposes within us. And what we need to understand is as that foundation is built within us, other people see the results of it. Other people are affected by it. We become the foundation for new life. In other words, by allowing God to build a foundation within us. Finally, it says in Psalm chapter 32, verse 8, that he guides us. I will guide you. Again, what this word means is it means to consult together. To consult together. Come, let us reason, is what God says in Isaiah. When we allow God to guide us, what we're doing is we're inviting the presence of Christ in us, which is our hope of glory, our hope of eternity. We become partners with him through the filling of his Holy Spirit. So friends, our God gives us comprehension. He gives us understanding. He builds a foundation within us, and then he fills us with his presence. This is what it means to allow the wisdom of God to be present within our lives. So before there's any wisdom within a crowd, there needs to be wisdom from above within the family of faith. So what we've done, we've explored the value of God's wisdom, and we've seen that there is wisdom in crowds as well. And this brings me to the Sermon on the Mount. Because it's at this place that we have the perfect storm, the perfect combination of both. We have there on the Sermon on the Mount, we have the crowd that is gathered together, and then we have God in human flesh speaking to that crowd. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 5. This is where we're going to be looking, Matthew chapter 5. And we'll be starting with verses 1 and 2. We're going to read through the Beatitudes, and then we're going to look at Matthew chapter 7 after that. That's going to be the flow of our message today. Again, the title of the message is Wisdom of Crowds or Wisdom in Crowds. And one flashpoint we see in Scripture is when God has something of eternal importance to say to his people, he does it in front of a crowd. Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. This is how it starts. It says, and seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain. And when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, what we see here is a very important moment in biblical history. And Matthew, as someone who was writing to Jewish people, he wanted them to understand something. He talked about multitudes and he talked about a mountain. So when he put those two together, a multitude and a mountain, their minds automatically went where? To Sinai. There was a multitude. And there was a mountain, and there was the presence of God. When it was time for Moses to receive God's standards for his covenant people, Israel, he went up on a mountain and came down with the laws, or what they say in Hebrew, the Torah, or a better word for it is instructions from God. God's instructions. And now near the start of Jesus' ministry, here in Matthew chapter 5, he went up on a mountain and he preached what we call the Sermon on the Mount. Now back in Exodus, when the people receive instructions from God on Sinai, there was a purpose for it. We call it the Ten Commandments as if God is saying, you must, you must, you must. You must do this, you must do that, you must do the other thing. But that's not what it was. The purpose was to teach them how to live a life of abundance and freedom. You were slaves. You were slaves over there in Egypt. But I brought you out. I brought you through the Red Sea. I brought you to this place. You have been set free from bondage, and now I'm providing you with instructions to how to live a thriving new life of freedom. However, what happened was these instructions became laws. And instead of leading to freedom, their misapplication of the Ten Commandments led them back into bondage. And friends, I'm sorry to say, sometimes today we have that same problem where we look at the Ten Commandments as things that are tying us down, that are holding us back, when God wants it to be something that is launching us forward into a life of abundance that we can never imagine. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus is reimagining what happened there at Sinai. Of course, he was there. And what's happening is the Sermon on the Mount was to remind the people that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The Sermon on the Mount was preached to put liberty, which comes through the presence of Jesus, back into the letter of the law. They were living by the letter of the law, following the law by guidelines. There were books written on laws to protect you from keeping the law, which was kept to protect you from keeping the actual law. There were layers of the law. It became a shackle for the people. And so Jesus, at the beginning of his ministry, he wanted to set the stage. You know, it's important, so important that we as Christians, we as followers and disciples of Jesus Christ, take time to meditate and understand the words spoken during this point in his ministry. The words of the Sermon on the Mount, specifically the Beatitudes, is what I'm going to be looking at today. They're so powerful because they paint a picture of what it means to live a life of freedom. It's also important to understand that these words can be best understood and applied through the wisdom of crowds. By this, what I mean is this: we are better equipped to understand the heart and love of God towards us as we live in Christian harmony with one another. In fact, if we look at the Beatitudes, they are talking about how we relate to one another. As we gain wisdom as a corporate body on how to live this way, we gain understanding of the love of God towards each and every one of us. The Beatitudes have 9 statements, and they set the stage of what it means to live in a state of blessing. Blessing. This word beatitude is not a biblical word. It comes from the Latin, and what it means is blessedness. Blessedness. But what we're going to see is this is a suitable word for Matthew chapter 5. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 12. Because in those verses, it describes 9 states of blessedness. And by blessedness, I mean what we're talking about is deep-seated well-being. Peace within your mind, within your heart. Peace with other people, even if they're not so peaceful towards you. You find a way to have that peace. Peace in the midst of a storm. It means to seek and experience joy in the face of adversity and disappointment. These words are experienced by those who practice the ethics of what it means to be a member, a citizen of God's kingdom. These 9 Beatitudes are not qualifications for salvation. Instead, these words are characterizations of the person whose life is closely aligned with God. It's not saying you're perfect. It just means you know how to live and be a part of God's kingdom. You know, sometimes you go to a house. I'm sure every one of your household, you have house rules. If someone breaks the rules, sometimes you don't say anything, but there are certain house rules, and everyone who lives in that house knows the rules, and if the rules are followed, everyone lives in harmony. God, who is the creator of the universe, the creator of us, the creator of all things, he's created these house rules, again, not to put us in bondage, but so that we can live in this synergetic relationship with him, and in such a way that we are in harmony with one another and in all the universe as well. To experience blessing, to experience God's peace that passes understanding, it's a result of living a life in harmony with the values and ethics of God's kingdom. Jesus characterized these under 9 different categories: to be poor in spirit, which means you need God; mourning, recognizing your need for forgiveness; meekness, which is humility; hunger for righteousness, which is a recognition of your own unrighteousness; mercy, which is extending mercy towards others; purity, which is saying I choose to avoid sin; peacemaking, which means I seek to find harmony and unity among those around me; and a willingness to be persecuted for God's sake, which is the last 2 of the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes, according to Matthew, mark the beginning of Jesus' public teaching ministry. They are the first things that Jesus emphasized before he went out. Before that, he was healing, and he was talking, and he was doing things, but this is the first thing that he emphasized. This is how he launched his preaching ministry, if you will. Jesus began his sermon on the Mount with promises of God's blessing on heart attitudes, on the way that our heart is. He began focusing on doing heart surgery, wanting to reconstruct our hearts, our very intentions, how we think about people. You know, it's not always what you say, but you know what you're thinking, and so does God. And this is what we're talking about when we're putting these Beatitudes into play. We focus on the thou shalt of the 10 commandments, but before he began proclaiming the commandments on Sinai, if we look at the relationship between what happens here and what happened on Sinai, before God said, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, remember, before he said all of these things, he said one thing. First and foremost, he says, I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of bondage. And just as I brought you out of bondage in Egypt, I will bring you into a heartfelt relationship with me and with one another. Here with the Beatitudes, Jesus is repeating, he's reiterating that message, because through the years it had been lost. The Beatitudes describe the foundational character quality and family characteristics Jesus wanted to be at work within his people. We often forget about the foundational importance of the Beatitudes. These words are meant to provide guidance for a life of abundance personally and corporately as a church. They represent, once again, the heart attitudes that should govern us, that should guide us, and it should be evident in all of our interactions. Let's take a look at these Beatitudes before we go any further. Matthew chapter 5, we're starting at verses 3. We're going to look through verse 12, and we're going to talk about them just for a moment. Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 to 12. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Let's take a look at these Beatitudes one by one. I'm going to reverse here on the slides. Blessed. It starts, blessed are the poor in spirit. The foundation for a relationship with God is what it's talking about here, to be poor in spirit. It means losing hope in yourself and finding hope only in God. Knowing that He is your only source of hope no matter what the situation is. Knowing that your spirituality, your morality, anything you do falls short of the glory of God. And the only way that you could reach that mark is to turn your eyes towards Jesus. Jesus teaches that the norm of the kingdom of heaven is spiritual bankruptcy, unlike the spiritual self-sufficiency that was a characteristic of the religious leaders. Blessed are those who mourn. This is the foundation of, we're not talking about mourning for the loss of someone. We're talking about mourning for the fact of what you have done to fall short of the glory of God. This is the foundation for repentance. It's seeing the true nature of sin within your heart. It's knowing that you have fallen short of that glory and you need to turn yourself over to God. It's being truly sorry to the point that not only do you say you're sorry, but you turn away from that way of living. Blessed are those who mourn, who realize that they can't do it alone, who realize that they have sinned, for they shall be comforted, meaning they shall be forgiven, they shall be restored, they shall be put back to the place where Adam and Eve were before sin. Blessed are the meek. The meek are those who are humble. They shall inherit the earth. You know, they say humility or meekness. It's not thinking less of yourself, but it's just thinking of others more than yourself. It's thinking of others more than you think about yourself. It's thinking about what are the needs of other people. It doesn't mean that you think lowly of yourself, but it just means that you're looking to see how you can be of assistance to others. This is a foundation of faith, a foundation of coming to God, of quieting your soul to trust God in all circumstances. That's what it means to be humble. Jesus exemplifies his best, but when he talks about being gentle, it takes tremendous strength to bring others into God's will. But when that strength is coupled with this selfless non-assertiveness, this meekness, it produces a gentle person who can patiently endure much more and bring the God's purposes to his people. Yes, you could do the assertive way. That can work. But the question is, does it build patience? And what is the end result of that? Because we're thinking of the other person, not ourselves, and getting the job done. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, the foundation for Christian living and sanctification. Do you hunger for a right relationship with God? Is it something that you truly desire? Are we pursuing holiness in our life? Are we pursuing holiness across the world? Righteousness is simply right living. It's living within the confines of God's kingdom. It's living with expectation of the kingdom to come, but with the awareness that the kingdom of God starts within. It's not saying I'm going to wait for Jesus to come before I get things right, or I'm going to wait until this certain time. No, it's knowing that the time is now. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the time of righteousness. It means seeking first the kingdom of God and all its righteousness so that everything else could be added to you. Blessed are the merciful. The foundation of Christian relationships is mercy. And mercy can be shown in so many different ways. It doesn't mean that someone is in need of mercy. It means that within your heart, you're showing mercy to them just because that's who you are. It means having that listening ear. It means taking time to truly make sure that you are looking to the needs and the cares of someone else, loving others as God loves them. What it means to be merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. they shall see God. The Bible talks about coming to God with a heart that is pure. It talks about worship. It talks about coming to God with your everything, having a vision of God, and taking time. What we're doing right now, the exercise we're doing right now in this church service, the songs we're singing, listening to scripture, the children's story, everything that happens here is bringing us to a place where our hearts will be pure because we're giving it all to Jesus and turning our attention towards God. And blessed are the peacemakers. The foundation of Christian mission is seeking to bring God's offer of peace to a hostile world. We live in a world where we can't ever seem to find peace and safety. Every time it seems like it's there, something happens to shift. And we need to be those who are conduits of peace within our small part of the world that we are over, a small part of the world that we influence. We need to be conduits of peace. And finally, the last two are blessed are the persecuted. This is the foundation of Christian perseverance. Jesus is coming soon, but we don't know when that is. But we do know that no matter what the circumstance or situation that leads us to that day, we need to persevere. We need to stand strong in the Lord and the power of his might. That's what he is calling us to do. That's what it means to be persecuted and to stand strong no matter what the situation. These areas of blessing, all of these beatitudes show us what it means to be a citizen of the kingdom. As the people were standing there, sitting there, listening to Jesus proclaim these Beatitudes, listening to Jesus proclaim the rest of his sermon, there was something that happened at the end. And this is where I'm going to close. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 28 to 29, a little typo there, here's what it says. This is at the very end of the message that Jesus gave, that very end of the sermon. This is where the wisdom of the crowds comes in. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching. For he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. The scribes were very rote. They would take the Bible, the scrolls, and they would read it, and they would say, this is what you need to do. But Jesus, somehow, some way, he went into the scripture. He had a deeper understanding of what the word was saying. And when they heard him speak, they were able to say, yes, I need to change. My life needs to be transformed. And what this verse is saying is that Jesus ended these sayings and the people collectively were astonished at his teaching. Astonished means that they just were, their minds were blown. That the word in the original language means that they were speechless. They didn't know what to say. They had never seen or experienced anything like what Jesus had done. Friends, when we take time to have wisdom within our community of faith, whether it's in small groups or whether it's time that we meet to worship God together, this level of astonishment and change is something that God is desiring to do within us as a church, but also as individuals. Friends, there is wisdom within crowds. There is wisdom within those who are looking for Jesus. And when we take the time to seek him, as I said, not just individually, but corporately, something special happens. It's my prayer today that as we move forward in our activities that we are doing as a church and our relationships that we're cultivating as a church family, that we will always keep in mind that we need to seek wisdom from one another. We need to see how God is intersecting within each other's lives so that it can help us grow together and bind us with ties that cannot be broken. And it will lead us to a place where we can follow the words of our closing song, stand up for Jesus. I'd like to invite you to stand up as we sing these words, stand up for Jesus. Shh. soldiers of the cross. Our praise team will come forward at this time. Father, as we contemplate the words of that song, we look forward to that day when you, the King of Glory, will reign with King Jesus. But until that day comes, Lord, may we be found faithful, finding wisdom in you, finding wisdom in our fellowship with one another, Lord. May we take time to contemplate the words that were spoken on that mountain and how it applies to us as followers of Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to stand up for you in every aspect of our lives, whether it's time to spend personally with you, our interaction with our peers, our interaction with one another as a church in this community. Our desire is to stand up for you. So, Lord, I pray that you would lift us up as you were lifted up on the cross and guide us, Lord, in all things. Now receive this benediction, and now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, to him be glory, be majesty, be dominion and power, both now and forever. Let the people of God say amen and amen. Please join us in the courtyard for our meet and greet following this service. God bless.